From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice. Here's your host.
Hello and welcome to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Preeti Malani, JAMA Deputy Editor. I'm joined by Dr. Christine Johnston, who is a professor of medicine in the Division of Allergy and Infectious Diseases and Medical Director at the University of Washington STD Prevention Training Center. Dr. Johnston and Dr. Anna Wald co-authored a JAMA Insights article on genital herpes, which was published on August 14th, 2024. Christine, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
So genital herpes is a sexually transmitted infection caused by herpes simplex virus, or HSV. Previously, it was thought that HSV-1 primarily caused oral and labial infections, and HSV-2 caused genital infections. However, genital HSV-1 is now known to affect millions of individuals worldwide and is currently the leading cause of newly diagnosed genital herpes infection in the U.S. In 2018, there were an estimated 18.6 million people in the U.S. that had genital HSV-2 infection, and many millions more with HSV-1. So this is a common infection. Furthermore, most people with genital HSV are asymptomatic and unaware of their infection. So with that brief background, let's talk about the natural history of genital HSV infection. Something that's characteristic of HSV and other herpes viruses is latency, the idea of persistent infection. Dr. Johnston, what do we know about symptomatic recurrences and viral shedding with genital herpes?
We know that HSV-2 infection causes about 4 to 5 recurrences per year in the first year after a symptomatic first episode infection. And HSV-1 recurs less frequently, but does cause, on average, 1 recurrence per year. The rates of recurrences go down somewhat over time, but people may have recurrences many years after their initial infection. And the recurrence rates are also highly variable, with some people having 0 to 1 recurrences and others having many recurrences per year, particularly with HSV-2 infection. In terms of the shedding rates, we also know that shedding happens even when there aren't necessarily clinical symptoms or recurrences. And that's important because shedding can be associated with transmission. Now, shedding rates in general are higher with HSV-2 than with HSV-1 infection, but asymptomatic shedding can occur with both infections.
Clinically speaking, what are typical symptoms that someone might experience with a genital HSV infection?
Well, a classic genital HSV infection would be characterized by starting out as painful vesicles and then progressing to ulcerations, which can really be quite symptomatic. These are self-limited ulcerations, so with recurrence, they would resolve within a couple of days. So that would be the most classic presentation. However, people can have atypical presentations. People may notice a minor itch or a slight discomfort in the genital area, and they may never realize they're having a genital herpes recurrence. People can also have a prodrome before they have recurrent genital herpes, and this could be characterized by numbness or tingling or itching sensation. And again, sometimes the symptoms are so mild that patients may not realize they're having a genital herpes recurrence.
Let's move on to diagnosis. How is a clinical diagnosis of genital HSV made?
It is important to know that screening for genital herpes is not currently recommended for asymptomatic adolescents and adults. This is rating from the U.S. Preventive Services Task Force. However, there are times when a serologic diagnosis is recommended, and these include when people have a partner with genital herpes, when people have symptoms or signs of genital herpes that may not have been diagnosed before as genital herpes, and also when people only have a clinical diagnosis and have not had virologic confirmation of their diagnosis. The diagnosis is made differently depending on whether people have symptoms or a genital herpes recurrence at the time when they're being seen at the clinic. If people do have a genital herpes recurrence, it should always be swabbed to make a virologic diagnosis. This would be a swab, which would be sent for typically PCR, that could differentiate between HSV-1 and HSV-2. And it is really important to differentiate between those infections because, as I mentioned earlier, the natural history is slightly different between them, with genital HSV2 having more recurrences. If people are presenting without symptoms at the time that you're seeing them, then you need to rely on a serology test, a serologic test, to make the diagnosis. The serologic assays also differentiate between HSV1 and HSV2, but that's where it gets a little bit complicated. With serology, you cannot tell if HSV1 infection is in the orolabial area or in the genital area. That just makes diagnosing genital herpes more difficult. In addition, our currently available serologic assays, many of them do have limitations with sensitivity and specificity. For instance, HSV2 serologic assays may have a high false positive rate, and so sometimes require confirmatory testing. For HSV1, there can be false positives as well.
This is really important for patients to understand as well as for clinicians, since the implications of a positive test could be very important socially for somebody. And you mentioned something interesting, that the natural history and the prognosis is a bit different between HSV1 and HSV2. So the reason to do the testing in some ways is to really help provide that prognostication. Would you agree with that?
Yes, I would absolutely agree with that. And I think it is really important for patients to know what type they have and to understand the natural history for their own infection. I think it can help them figure out management issues, as we'll talk about later, using suppressive therapy potentially, or even how to talk to partners.
So let's shift to treatment and prevention. With HSV, there are antivirals that can provide effective treatment. Can you summarize the various approaches to antiviral treatment?
Absolutely. So we really have one class of medications to treat genital herpes, and these are the nucleoside analogs. They are acyclovir, valacyclovir, and famciclovir. These medications were developed decades ago, and we really don't have any newer options to treat genital herpes. That said, these medications work fairly well to prevent and treat genital herpes recurrences. The two approaches to treatment are suppression. So this would be giving patients a medication each day to decrease the risk of vaginal herpes recurrence. And this can also decrease the risk of transmission to sexual partners. The other main treatment approach is using episodic therapy. And this would be giving each patient a course of medication to have available if they have a recurrence. And this would typically be a 2 to 5 day treatment course, depending on the dosage and the medication that's used. I will say that many patients are not aware of suppression as an option. And I think it is a really valuable option for patients to know about suppressive therapy and to see if it's right for them. Generally, suppressive therapy is something that is a patient-driven decision. So there are some patients who may have 1 or 2 recurrences per year, and they may not want to have another recurrence, and they may be good candidates for suppression. Other people are not that bothered by their recurrences and may prefer to have an episodic approach. But really what's most important is making sure that your patient knows about these options and can choose between them based on what's right for them.
How about prevention? How can the risk of transmission be managed?
We don't have perfect methods to prevent transmission, but as I mentioned, we can use suppressive therapy. A large study showed that suppressive valacyclovir, taken once daily, prevented the risk of transmission by about 48% among discordant couples. People can also use condoms to prevent transmission, but they are not as effective as they are with other STIs. So there is still a risk of transmission, even with consistent condom use, although it does decrease the risk of transmission. And then our other advice right now is just if you have symptoms or a recurrence, to avoid sex during those times.
We don't always talk about stigma and its importance when thinking about the management of a sexually transmitted infection. Your article includes a short section on stigma. What should clinicians know about stigma and genital herpes?
Genital herpes is a unique STI in that it doesn't have a cure. And it really affects the way patients approach their sexual health and their sexual identity, especially when getting that first diagnosis. The impact on sexual health, concerns about disclosure, concerns about transmission are really paramount for the patients, and they are really thinking about this. The other thing we've heard from patients is, given these really significant concerns, is that sometimes their providers may not be aware of what type of an impact this diagnosis has. Genital herpes has a lasting impact on how people really see themselves as sexual beings and participating in sexual activity throughout their future. So it is important to realize that for providers. It's also really important to decrease the stigma by providing accurate information about genital herpes to the patients. People may search online for genital herpes cures. It is rife with misinformation. And so really understanding that natural history, understanding the risk of transmission, understanding even accurate diagnostics, it's really, really important for your patients, and providing that safe space both to talk about issues around genital herpes and also providing accurate information can really help decrease the stigma.
And of course, in this situation, there are effective ways to manage and treat. So it is even that much more important.
Yes, absolutely. We do have some tools, although we always hope for more effective tools. We do have many tools to manage this infection. So giving that accurate information is really important.
Dr. Christine Johnston, thank you for joining me, and thank you for writing a wonderful Insights article.
Thank you so much for having me.
This episode was produced by Shelley Steffens at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com.